The first step to learning endoscopic anatomy is to do a meticulous diagnostic endoscopy, which consists of basically three passes. The first pass is made by advancing the scope between the inferior turbinate and the septum up to the nasopharynx. Both the Eustachian tube orifices can be seen. The scope is advanced further to view the fossa of Rosenmüller. A better view can be obtained by rotating the scope or using an angled telescope. The scope is then withdrawn and rolled under the inferior turbinate to enter the inferior meatus and view the lower opening of the nasolacrimal duct. The patency of the system can be tested by syringing. The second pass is made by advancing the scope along the floor of the nose up to the posterior coana. The scope is then rotated upwards along the anterior face of the sphenoid to view the sphenoid ostium, which lies between the superior turbinate and the septum, approximately 1 to 1.5 centimeters above the roof of the posterior coana. The third pass is made by passing the scope lateral to the middle turbinate to view the structures in the middle meatus. The first structure to be seen is the uncinate process. This is the uncinate process, which is boomerang shaped. It consists of a vertical part, an intermediate part, and a horizontal part. This is the bulla. The crescentic groove between the uncinate process and the bulla is the hiatus semilunaris, which leads into the infundibulum, which further leads into the maxiostium behind the intermediate portion of the uncinate process. The middle turbinate, when traced backwards, turns laterally behind the bulla to attach to the lamina papyracea. This is the ground lamella. The middle meatus can also be entered by passing the scope medial to the middle turbinate, rolling it under the middle turbinate, and then withdrawing it to view the structures in the middle meatus. The middle turbinate has three main attachments. Its most anterior attachment is to the frontonasal process of the maxilla and to the cribriform plate. This anterior attachment of the middle turbinate, or the axilla, is an important surgical landmark. The intermediate attachment of the middle turbinate is the ground lamella or the basal lamella. On passing the scope posteriorly, one can see its posteriormost attachment to the perpendicular plate of the palatine bone at the level of the posterior coana. To summarize, the anteriormost attachment to the cribriform plate and the frontonasal process of the maxilla, the intermediate attachment to the lamina papyracea, and the posteriormost attachment to the palatine bone. An uncinectomy can be done in various ways, the safest being using a backbiting forceps. This forceps is inserted into the infundibulum, the uncinate process is unrolled, and a bite is taken off the process. This is done repeatedly till one gets the classical Parsons window in the uncinate process. The horizontal part of the uncinate process is dissected submucosally to expose the normal maxillary ostium. The ostium is widened posteriorly. It is joined to any accessory ostium which may be present at this point. The horizontal part of the uncinate process is removed with a straight forceps. The interior of the maxillary sinus can then be inspected. This is better done using an angled telescope such as a 30 or a 70 degree telescope. An attempt is made to view all the walls of the maxillary sinus. One should ideally not probe the maxillary sinus blindly. If it becomes necessary, this should be done in an inferior direction just above the inferior turbinate. The frontal recess can sometimes be viewed directly using an angled telescope just below the anterior attachment of the middle turbinate. A 70 degree telescope can give this sort of a view. To access the frontal recess, the upper part of the uncinate process needs to be removed. The uncinate process is unrolled using a ballpoint. It is then removed using an upward biting Blakesley forceps. The forceps is held parallel to the lamina papyracea and the uncinate process is detached using a twisting movement of the forceps. Any remnant tags are removed so as to skeletonize the lamina papyracea, as can be seen here. Once this is done, the uppermost portion of the uncinate process is seen attaching to the lamina papyracea and enclosing within it the recessus terminalis. Medial to the uncinate process is a recess which reads into the frontal sinus. The uppermost portion of this uncinate process is removed using a Coons probe. This is classically called uncapping the egg. As these bony partitions are removed, the entrance to the frontal sinus comes clearly into view. The bulla has been perforated using a ballpoint probe. This opening is widened using an elevator. The bulla in the antiethmoidal air cells are systematically removed using a straight forceps. As the antiethmoidal air cells are removed completely, one can see the lamina papyracea laterally, the middle turbinate medially, the base skull superiorly, and the ground lamella posteriorly. Once all the anterior ethmoidal cells have been removed, one may be able to see more cells in the frontal recess area. These can be removed using a ballpoint probe. Care should be taken to direct all instruments laterally. An upward biting Blakesley forceps can also be used. Once all the cells in this area have been removed, one can study the anatomy clearly. This is the antiethmoidal artery. This is a cell anterior to it forming part of the frontal recess. And further anteriorly is the opening to the frontal sinus. The antiethmoidal artery, a cell anterior to it, and the frontal sinus. The ground lamella is seen extending from the middle turbinate up to the lamina papyracea. It is not opened laterally as one would enter the orbit. But more medially as shown here. After opening the ground lamella with a ballpoint probe and confirming the presence of air, this opening is widened using an elevator. The much larger posterior ethmoidal cells can now be seen. Most of the ground lamella and all the posterior ethmoidal cells are meticulously removed. The rest of the lamina papyracea is skeletonized. Once all the posterior ethmoidal cells have been removed, one can see the posteriormost ethmoidal cell, which is pyramidal in shape with its apex pointing away from the surgeon. In this case, the cell has grown superior lateral to the sphenoid sinus and is the classical Onodi cell. The optic nerve can be seen in its lateral wall. Care should be taken not to direct the forceps laterally. As shown here, but parallel to the lamina papyracea or more medially. The Stankiewicz sign, that is movement of the lamina papyracea on applying pressure to the eyeball, can be seen here. The skeletonized base skull can be seen. As one traces it anteriorly, it turns from horizontal to vertical to form the posterior wall of the frontal sinus. At the point at which it turns from horizontal to vertical is located the anterior ethmoidal artery. Further behind is the posterior ethmoidal artery, and still further is the optic nerve. The lateral approach to the sphenoid sinus is through the posterior ethmoidal cells. An imaginary line is drawn at the junction of the upper border of the maxiosteum and the lamina papyracea. When it is extrapolated backwards, then the cells opening above this line in a coronal plane are the posterior ethmoid cells. The cell which opens below this line in an inferomedial direction is the sphenoid sinus. The sphenoid sinus is opened with a probe. The presence of air is confirmed, and then this opening is widened using an elevator. One can now clearly see the orientation of the Onodi cell to the sphenoid sinus. The interior of the sphenoid sinus is globular and rounded like the inside of a pot, unlike the posteriormost ethmoidal cell, which is pyramidal in shape. This can be well appreciated here. The lower border of the ground lamella is kept intact so as to maintain the stability of the middle turbinate. The middle turbinate is dissected through at this point to gain access to the sphenoethmoidal recess. The superior turbinate is skeletonized. It is then retracted laterally to enter the sphenoethmoidal recess and visualize the sphenoid ostium. The sphenoid sinus can then be entered. The sphenoid sinus can be approached medially by retracting the middle turbinate laterally. The scope is advanced up to the roof of the posterior coana, and the sphenoid ostium is located 1 to 1.5 centimeters above it. It lies partially hidden by the superior turbinate. The sphenoid ostium can be widened inferiorly, taking care not to damage the sphenopalatine artery. The sphenoid sinus is entered and its contents can be studied. Along the lateral wall superiorly lies the optic nerve. Below and a little behind it is the internal carotid artery, which appears clinically dehiscent in this case. Between the two is the optico-carotid recess. A septum is often seen attaching to these structures. The nasolacrimal system lies anterior to the uncinate process and above the inferior turbinate. If the inferior turbinate is traced in an anterior to posterior direction, one can see that it peaks at a particular point. A ridge can be seen extending superiorly from this peak anterior to the uncinate process. This ridge overlies the nasolacrimal duct and the lacrimal sac above it. This is the same anatomy seen in a dissected specimen. the peak and the ridge overlying the nasolacrimal system. A semicircular incision is made using a sickle knife, starting at the anti-attachment of the middle turbinate and extending downwards up to the inferior turbinate. The mucosal flap is elevated using a periosteal elevator. This flap can be preserved and used in various ways to line the bare bone. The bone overlying the lacrimal sac is then removed using a kerosene sponge. It is important to note that the lacrimal bone is almost paper-thin bone, whereas the frontonasal process of the maxilla is relatively thick bone. This is the frontonasal process, and that is the lacrimal bone. The bone overlying the junction of the lacrimal sac and the nasolacrimal duct is also removed. Care should be taken to remove the bone as high as is possible. One may occasionally need to use a drill to remove this bone. The presence of the lacrimal sac is confirmed by applying gentle digital pressure at the medial canthus. Thank you. some fragments of bone overlying the junction of the lacrimal sac to the nasolacrimal duct can be seen. These are dissected off as well. After exposing the sac adequately, an incision is taken in it using a sharp sickle knife or a guarded stab knife. The lumen of the sac is identified. Any adhesions within the lumen of the sac are broken. The patency of the sac is confirmed by syringing.